Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Paul Salem. I'm the Vice President for Policy and Research at the Middle East Institute. Welcome all to this session on advancing regional cooperation for stability and growth in the Middle East. I want to welcome you all. I also want to particularly welcome one of our board members, Judge William Webster. Thank you for being here. Our event is being recorded for posting in video and podcast form. So mobile devices on silent, please, so that they don't become part of the event itself. And before starting this event, I want to just mention our next event, and it'll be the last one before the holidays. This will be Thursday of next week, December 15. We will be presenting the latest polling data that James Zugby has completed, polling on public opinion in 9 countries in the Middle East. Very interesting and fresh information. This will be at the Carnegie Endowments building on Mass Ave. Jim Zogby will present his findings, and then there'll be a discussion including Stephen Cook, Ellen Leibson, and Hassan Amnaimi, and Jerry Firestein. Hassan and Jerry are both at the Middle East Institute. Steve and Ellen at colleague institutions. You can sign on through our website to get details and to register for that event. Why regional cooperation? Why is it something that we decided to focus on? Well, the short answer is that the absence of even minimal regional cooperation in the Middle East, and I mean particularly between the big players, Iran, Turkey, Saudi Arabia, UAE, Egypt, and so on, is, if not one of the main drivers, perhaps the main driver of instability in the region, of civil wars, state failure, radicalization, rise of ISIS, and other groups like that, spread of Hezbollah, and so on, to say nothing of the enormous lost economic opportunity cost. So the absence of even minimal regional de-escalation or cooperation certainly is sort of the glaring, one of the big glaring problems in the Middle East. If one looks around the world, it is definitely the least organized, the least ordered region on the globe. It's also when we talk about sort of what the region is going through, we hear about issues of transition and states going through things. We also think, in a sense, that the region is going through a phase of transition. And as we've seen in countries where some form of change and perhaps transition begins, the first thing that happens is dysfunction, tension, often conflict, and in some cases, abject failure. So even if there might be some long-term trend, the short-term is often very, very difficult. Is the issue of regional de-escalation, cooperation, is it anything realistic? Is it possible? Looking at the current realities, the easy answer would be no. Some people say this might be thinking outside the box. In a way, we don't even see the box from where we're sitting. It's really not based on sort of current behavior. But the region itself has passed through similar proxy wars. Some of you might recall back in the 50s and 60s, Egypt and Saudi Arabia were locked in a proxy war in Yemen, in Syria, in Jordan, in Iraq, for control of the region. The Arab-Israeli conflict dominated the region for decades and caused wars and instabilities. And yet, the Arab Cold War sort of ended and is somewhat behind us. The Arab-Israeli conflict is more focused now as an Israeli-Palestinian conflict, but no more something that's hitting the region. So one can imagine from that sense that there might come a day where the Iranian, Arab, Sunni-Shi'i war might be something in the rearview mirror. And part of our work is to try to hasten that, to think forward, to think beyond the current logic. Also, as we'll hear from some of our panelists, and particularly from Ross Harrison, other regions have been here before. East Asia was mired in conflict, international intervention, the Vietnam War, the Chinese Revolution, and yet they found a way towards stability. Europe tore itself apart between World War I and World War II, much worse than what the Middle East is going through, and yet they found a way forward. So our project is not naive in the sense that we recognize the dim and grim realities, but sort of as historians, in a sense, we also recognize that times change and we should be able to think in alternative ways. This project that we're presenting part of today is a research project that will end up being published as a book, but we've also integrated this type of thinking and work into other parts of what we do at the Middle East Institute. Particularly, it's become part of our ongoing Track 2 dialogue that involves officials from the region, Iranians, Turks, Saudis, Qataris, Emiratis, as well as from China, Russia, Europe, and the U.S. So it's become part of addressing and reaching out to players in the region. The project that we're presenting part of today is composed of 10 very interesting research papers. They're all available online on our website. They cover issues of regional conflict and regional cooperation on a number of sectors. These include the issues of economic integration, trade, investment, and customs, and so on. They include energy, oil and gas, pipelines, resources, challenges of climate change. They also talk about water resources and how cooperation can impact that. And we also have made an attempt at looking at military conflict, military cooperation, and internal security conflict and internal security cooperation, as well as looking at the big picture of regional systems. How do they start? How do you go from conflict to cooperation? We asked each of our scholars in these projects to do three things. One, to look at their sector, whether it's water or energy, to look at it as it is today in today's Middle East, and to project if the current sort of habits continue, what would things look like around 2030? If this absence of cooperation continued, what would our crisis look like in water? What would it look like in economic growth or lack of it? What would it mean in terms of stability? So scenario one was things continue as they are through 2030. Scenario two was, well, what if we imagined cooperation in economics or energy or water or internal security? What would that look like in that sector, and where would we be in 2030? What benefits would accrue? In that sense, trying to highlight the cost sectorally to lack of cooperation or conflict and the opportunities that would accrue from cooperation. And the third thing we asked from each of our authors is to sort of lead us, if they were advising policymakers, what would the first steps of cooperation in that particular sector look like, departing from where we realistically are today? If we want to change customs regimes or we want to improve energy infrastructure, what could realistically be done? I'm very lucky that we have four of our authors with us today. We were going to have a fifth author as well, and that's Karine Hanlon. She wrote the paper on internal security and ways of boosting cooperation on internal security. Unfortunately, she's ill and is not able to make it with us today. So we have four of our authors, and I'll introduce them briefly. You have a list of their papers and brief bios in the handouts. In the order that I will sort of start the discussion, to my far left is Shahrokh Fardoust. He's a research professor at the College of William and Mary, and he wrote a brilliant paper on economic challenges and economic integration in the Middle East. To my immediate left is Jean-Francois Seznec. He's an MEI scholar, but also an adjunct professor at Johns Hopkins here at CSIS. And he wrote a paper on the potential for intra-regional energy cooperation. To my right is Anthony Cordesman, the Arleigh Burke Chair in Strategy at CSIS nearby, and he wrote on issues of military cooperation in the MENA region in the uncertain environment in which we live. And to my extreme right is my collaborator on this project. We conceived of the project together and have worked together in all steps of this project, is Ross Harrison, who's an MEI scholar, but also a faculty member at the Georgetown University School of Foreign Service and at the University of Pittsburgh. Ross contributed two papers to this project. The first paper, which was about looking at regional strategy, sort of broadly conceived in the Middle East, and the last paper, which we just released this morning, actually, looks at how other regions went from conflict to cooperation and what lessons we can learn from that. I failed to thank and to mention our cooperation here with the Johns Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies and with our friend and colleague, Professor Dan Serwer, who directs the program and is also an MEI scholar. So we thank them for hosting us here. So let's get right into it. I'll pitch a few opening questions and lead a bit of Q&A with our panelists, and then we'll open it up for a Q&A with you, hoping to end at 1:30. And let me start with Shahrokh. Let me start with you first. In your paper, you look at economic integration, I might say, from two directions, sort of the bottom up, what countries can do, perhaps in reforming their own systems and how that sort of naturally helps regional cooperation. But you've also mentioned the need, sometimes you call it something like a Marshall Plan or some sort of bigger approach to the problems of the region. What do you see are the main economic pathways that could lead us from where we are today to a more cooperative future?
Thank you very much. Is this on? Okay. First of all, I'm very honored to be part of this panel of experts. I'm just an economist, and I know only some of the countries in the region well. But my job, I used to be at the World Bank, is also we used to do long-term forecasting for the global economy and scenarios. So I try to apply what I knew to the region. And the bottom line, as far as the key message, is that the region is at the knife edge. It's an extremely dangerous point where the horse seems to be standing still because the large economies are still functioning, but the cracks are all over this building. And one more shock, global or regional, could bring the whole thing down. And I think it is really incumbent on the countries in the region, as well as the international community, to start this process of getting out of this knife edge region and condition. And that requires two things: domestic reforms, meaningful domestic reforms, and beginning of getting integrated within the region. Because global conditions are going to be dictated by major economic powers, US, Europe, and Japan. And as far as we know, the growth in these countries and regions are going to be pretty slow by this historical standards. And maybe even trade integration that has been reached at the global level has already reached a peak. It may be slowing down, as well as the global financial integration may have reached a peak and going down. So, but the region has to stand up on its own resources and its own economic needs, and that can be done. It's under their control, not anyone else's, the mm-hmm. leadership in these countries. Meaningful domestic economic reforms, together with some dialogue on certain things that I think the other panelists will refer to. There are some low-hanging fruits on beginning this cooperation situation.
Like, what are some low-hanging fruits that you see in your sectors?
Well, the region is, I think, has a lot of potential in trade in services, for example. You know, tourism, health, education, joint research, engineering consulting, construction services, which has not been really utilized in a meaningful way. Trade is more challenging because some of them are just very dependent on oil. But again, in that area, there could be some open. But I would go for areas where there is comparative advantage within the region and they can work together, probably trade and services. And some areas where are really common dangers facing them, climate change and water especially. Because if the water situation in the Middle East gets worse, that will add to the risks that the whole region is facing. I think we know that the Syrian situation was in part triggered mm-hmm. by water shortage.
You mentioned a bit and in your paper you mentioned it, but also recent developments have impacted this, you know, issues of globalization, a bit of a sort of a retrenchment in globalization. Some people look at regionalization as, in a sense, part of globalization, that opening up your economy and so on. And some maybe see it almost as an alternative, that if the global economy is slowing down, we have to invest regionally. How do you compare the two dynamics?
Well, Middle East region is the least integrated region in the world. There are hardly any airlines to fly to all of the capitals. There are hardly any roads that connect them all together. So there is a lot of things that could, you know, it's really at zero level that could be built up. Creates employment, brings about some. This is a region that has been on the Silk Road and, you know, been trading for many years. They have had a very dynamic business community, the bazaars, and the merchants and so forth. So this is not that, you know, these groups have not disappeared. The talents and skills are there. They're just hobbled by the security and conflict issues, which are absorbing huge amount of resources, and they're just basically fighting each other. There's no really global power coming there to dictate to them or to invade them. So it's really neighbors have to work it out. So these resources are being wasted. So I would say, because this region is so much less integrated, so there is some growth and stimulus could be had by beginning that process. I think East Asia is an example. I mean, maybe we have seen in the news that China is trying now to base impetus to its growth on the regional trade, because they're seeing at the global level there is going to be some hurdles. There are two aspects to regional trade. We could go to it in a little bit detail later on, but much of trade within East Asia, for example, has to do with these value chains. So they are trading with each other, but there are components of goods they're co-producing, and they're exporting to other regions. Only half of the trade within East Asia with really final goods within the region. But I think for Middle East, it could be actually, there is very little value chain going on because of lack of reforms and lack of integration to the world economy. So I think the requirement for integration is reform, beginning to open up their own economies to the global economic system, because they're still, except for GCC, they're fairly closed. And second is to begin the regional dialogue. So my optimism comes from the fact that there is very little impetus right now or recently, and so there could be something that you go from zero to one. It's a huge percentage increase.
Well, you mentioned a lot that a lot is in the initiative of the regional states and the players and so on, but you've also mentioned the issue of a Marshall Plan. My question is, what does the international community, whether it's private sector or governments or international institutions, what is required is it a prerequisite externally, or is it something that can be done regionally?
Yeah, the key message, again, in a report that I've written, is that you can't get all the big bang per buck from just domestic reform. You can't get, a big effect on growth and employment just by integrating with the world. They have to happen at the same time. You get much more positive effect on growth and employment generation if you reform your economy and then integrate, or you're doing it at the same time. And the region has a lot of room to maneuver, because they have really not taken the reform very seriously, because it's been awash with many of the countries have been awash with money up to recently, and that's not going to be the case for foreseeable future. Now, in terms of Marshall Plan that I have proposed, it's a mini Marshall Plan, is that the region, in order to feel secure and begin the process of integration, there are countries that have to be reconstructed, mostly in Syria, Yemen, Libya, parts of Iraq. That would require regional participation. That they have huge sovereign wealth funds that could participate in that reconstruction, but also the international community has to come in. Once that is done, I think it then it would be much easier to undertake reforms at the regional level, because you bring confidence back to the world mm-hmm. that it is a safe region to invest in. Because a lot of people think that, you know, if there is turmoil in country X, but country Y next door is safe, there is going to be a lot of FDI coming mm-hmm. in. No, that's not the case, because many businesses look at the region as a whole. And so you can unleash a lot more investment from other countries into the region where there is some basic security and stability is returned. And in order to bring back almost 9 million refugees from mm-hmm. the region, I think 60% or more are just from Syria alone, which has added some 25-30% to the population of Lebanon and Jordan. Mm-hmm. And also there have been, so these are huge things that could actually bring about impetus to growth within the region by reconstruction and bringing back some stability to the region. So I meant for, but the domestic reforms in the big countries like Egypt, Iran, Turkey, Saudi Arabia can go on without foreign assistance. I mean, Egypt, of course, there has an IMF program and so forth. Hopefully, it will succeed in unleashing some growth. But the four big countries can actually unleash reforms on their own. And some of them are talking about it. Saudi Arabia has a 2030 plan. Iran has the sixth five-year plan and so forth. Egypt is on IMF program. Hopefully, Turkey will go back to where it was a few years ago because it was a great example for the region. So there are possibilities are there. It requires political will.
Thank you so much, Shahrokh. Let me turn to Jean-Francois. The issue in the region since the 20s and 30s has often been energy. The big players, Saudi Arabia, the Gulf countries, Iran, Iraq are all energy producers. Turkey is a big energy transport point. Offshore gas finds in Eastern Mediterranean might be interesting. Russia, so there's a lot that that is driven by energy questions, and energy could be perhaps a source of cooperation and common interest, or obviously a source of conflict and fighting over it. What are the key points in your paper where you see perhaps examples of cooperation, potential for cooperation, and a vision that could sort of be a driver for more cooperation generally?
Well, until now, really, there has been extremely little cooperation within the countries. In fact, that was the I had the easiest paper, because the answer to is there cooperation, the answer is no. So you have to expand from there. But in fact, there has been a little bit of cooperation. There has been a lot of efforts in the past to have cooperation. Most of them have failed. There was a very interesting pipeline from Iraq going through Syria, and that was basically shut down for political reasons and the fights between the various Ba'ath parties in the two countries. But there's been a number of these examples which always fell through for political reasons, not for economic reasons, which would have profited in the case of Syria and Iraq. Both countries would have profited enormously from that. But if I have to choose one example that worked, and it's probably the only one, is the Dolphin project in the UAE between Qatar and the UAE, where Qatar sells gas to the UAE and to Oman through a pipeline. And that has been fairly successful. There was a lot of conflicts about, I mean, not armed conflict, but a lot of tension about this, because the Saudis were totally opposed to this project, because they thought the pipeline would go through their territorial water. There was a dispute where the UAE and Qatar says, no, you don't have territorial waters there, but the Saudis said they did. Anyway, it ended up being accepted, and they did it. It's working, and now they have problems with the pricing because the UAE took advantage of Qatar really at the time. But now it's getting better. Qatar is really eager to export, so they're making a little more. They've agreed to increase the transfer of gas to the UAE and to Oman. So that has been a positive. But otherwise, there's been very, very little. The only other one that could have had a major impact on in the MENA region was the pipeline that takes natural gas from Hassir Mel in Algeria to Europe. And there are three pipelines now, but one of the main ones, the first one, was to take gas through Morocco. And Morocco could have taken very much advantage of some of that gas for its own development, and it has a little bit of that gas, but very, very little. The relationship between the two countries are terrible for reasons that have nothing to do with energy. Mm-hmm. And I might go into this a little later, because that, I think, a very hopeful situation if it were not only based on politics. So really very, very little cooperation until now. We'll see how that develops, because if these countries could work together, they could really multiply their business and their value added, create jobs, and so on these issues.
If you look at the sort of energy markets moving forward, long-term low or lowish oil prices, which is already impacting the budgets of mm-hmm. most of these countries, maybe somewhere between $40 and $60 mm-hmm. long-term, plus the rise of alternative energies and so on. But looking at sort of these energy economies, which are the major players, is an environment of long-term low oil prices something that might spur cooperation rather than high oil prices where everybody's just happy with what they have and they don't need to do anything differently?
Well, I personally think that the low oil prices is a blessing for the mm-hmm. region, because all of a sudden they have to really focus on what do you do post-oil. And the Saudis have been, you know, focusing on this since 1975. They've had some success on that, but now they have to put all they've done on steroids and really multiply it so that the income will come from value-added productions, not just from selling crude oil. And the states have to adapt to that. Now, if they can work together on these matters, I think it would help a great deal. For instance, Qatar and Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is basically very short on cheap natural gas. They have natural gas from their own oil, which is very cheap, but that is, they use all of it all the time. They need more gas. They found some dry gas, which they are trying to get out of the ground, which is very expensive. But they could get gas from Qatar for almost nothing because it's right next door. God forbid they could get gas from Iran, which is also the Iran gas field is closer to Saudi Arabia than it is to Iran, basically, where they could use it. And there'd be tremendous amount of exchanges, which would be good for Saudi Arabia and good for the other countries, because the Saudis have tremendous knowledge of chemicals, of metals, of fertilizers, and there could be exchanges on mm-hmm. this basis. Mm-hmm. But that hasn't happened yet. Mm-hmm. And, you know, hopefully the relationship between Qatar and Saudi Arabia is improving so that we may see that in the future one day. And maybe that could be the base of a future between Iran and Saudi Arabia. We'll see. Mm-hmm. In terms of Algeria and Morocco, I have the secret hope, which I don't normally talk about very much, to see that if the Algerians were willing to sell gas to Morocco and transport it to, say, Laayoun down in the Moroccan Sahara, well, you could have a system where the natural gas of Algeria could be used to really make very high value-added products based on the phosphates that are right there. Mm-hmm. And if you could have that and bring the Sahrawi people as shareholders as well, then you'd have peace between the various communities. The Algerians would be happy, the Moroccans would be happy, but no, now we don't talk to each other, we've closed the borders. Mm-hmm. And so, but there would be potential, great potential mm-hmm. there. But anyway, we have not seen that. But that, in my view, would be a very low hanging fruit. It would not take that much money or time. Mm-hmm. And we'll see.
Let me ask you a question about the markets for this energy. In the past, it used to go west, now it's going east.
Yes.
The U.S. has had, obviously, very difficult relations with Iran and hence has been part of the conflict system in the region. China's emerging one road, one belt policy, particularly as relates, well, to trade, but also energy, is on good terms with everybody. Mm. Do you see any potential there, given that sort of China and Asia's interest in the oil is non-political in that sense, that there could be some sort of win-wins there or encouragement of cooperation on energy going east?
Yes, and it's happening already very much. I mean, in Saudi Arabia has very, very large investments in China, in Korea, and in Japan on energy, not just energy, but going downstream on chemicals, very large. And the Chinese are trying to do more in China. There are a lot of contacts right now, which was very iffy in the past few years, but now there's a big push. The Saudis are not so happy with us, so they're really pushing the Chinese angle. And that is, yes, very much so. I think the Far East, and not just China, but Japan also. Japan has a lot more investments in Saudi Arabia than basically anyone else except the U.S. So there is a lot of talks and exchanges, and not just in crude oil or natural gas, in way downstream, in very high value-added productions based on cheap energy, because that's where they have a trade advantage, which the professor was mentioning. So I think, yes, I think the Far East is really, we are now seeing a development there between each countries of the Far East and of the Middle East and the Chinese and the Japanese. Now, whether or not they could make a deal with the GCC, and that would make life a lot easier and make trade deals a lot faster. But even the GCC is not truly an economic organization. I mean, it's a defense organization, but it's very hard for them to if China signed with the GCC, no one knows whether the deals would be accepted by the members of the GCC privately. So we'll see how that goes. But there is very definitely a trend towards the Far East on this matter.
Let me ask you a final question on the Mediterranean offshore gas issue on two levels. One, potentially, it's a driver for cooperation for Israel to get its gas to Europe. It might need to go through Turkey. Obviously, a lot of this impacts the Cyprus situation, the conflict there. Egypt also needs ways either to get or to export. If one day Lebanon and Syria also produce, they have to go regionally. So there's a regional aspect, but also there's a global, the Russian interest, and some people say their presence in Syria is partly to have a hand in that. How do you see, how important is the Eastern Med offshore gas sector given today's market and prices, and how do you see it driving things?
From a purely pricing standpoint, it's not so important because the price is very low for natural gas, and therefore the investments will be huge because this is all offshore.
Very deep.
And very deep. So very expensive to get that gas out. On the other hand, it's very much needed. The Europeans could use East Med gas to sort of diversify away from Russia, hence why maybe they want to have a say in how things are going. The Turks are very involved in this because, as you pointed out earlier, the Turks are very much of a switching zone for the natural gas from all over the place going into Europe. So I think it's a very important area because it's relatively close. It would be a lot cheaper to send gas from the Eastern Med than from Qatar, for instance. The only gas going from Qatar now is the gas going, you know, on the LNG tankers. There could be pipelines really built either through Israel into Turkey and so on, or big LNG plants, which is very expensive as well. So I think it's vital. I think people are paying very close attention to it, but there are issues. I mean, the Lebanese-Israeli border is not defined. So the Lebanese and the Israelis are claiming the same gas field or part of the same gas field. Same for the Cyprus has some problems, and the Turks don't want to always allow the Cypriots to do things because, I mean, the history. And Egypt, of course, would be a vital player there because, but Egypt now is very short of natural gas. It has all these big LNG plants that are idle because they can't use them. Now, they just discovered some new fields which will allow them to have enough gas for themselves so they don't have to import it anymore. They used to be exporter. That will probably improve things. Some of that East Med gas could be used in Egypt in these LNG plants that are idle. That would be great because that's a great exchange. Everybody benefits from that. So we'll see how that develops. But there, it's vital, but it is a long haul.
Thank you very much, Jean-Francois. Let me turn to Dr. Cordesman. The military sector in any part of the world is probably the last or maybe never integrates easily with other countries or even regionally. In the Middle East, obviously, it's perhaps the most expensive one in the sense that, you know, billions and billions are spent in this sector, which are obviously economically not very productive. There might also be sectors where, you know, permanent kind of conflict is just part of the way they have to plan and they have to prepare. Now, in your paper, you mentioned there have been attempts at the in the past, whether it was the Baghdad Pact or the Arab League. Attempts at cooperation haven't gone too well. The GCC is, you know, kind of an example at an attempt at cooperation. Saudi Arabia has announced a number of coalitions, one to fight in Yemen, one to fight terrorism. And all the while, the U.S. has been involved in a lot of these initiatives in the region. How do you see, you know, any potential for de-escalation and at some point forms of cooperation, even if they're sub-regional in the region? And could we learn something from other regions that have attempted this?
You know, I warned the authors,
yes,
that I was not a great believer in the prospects for regional cooperation in any of these areas. I think that very often we confuse good intentions with outcomes. And I have to say that in general, my advice to my students is whenever you hear two phrases, regional or international community, you know nothing successful is going to happen. And you can leave the room.
Good to know.
The fact
we urge you not to leave the room.
The fact is that I think in practice, it is not the lack of regional cooperation that is the problem. It is the fact that the countries involved have very different region interests. They are not symmetrical so that they don't cooperate or fail to cooperate in the same ways in energy, economics, politics, security, or the military. And when you look across the region, you see that if you want a successful coalition, it is necessarily going to be relatively limited, as it is in practice in NATO. Whatever the facade is in NATO, and I quote one of my ambassadors there when I was in the NATO force planning exercise, the reality is that when NATO is effective, it is only effective among those countries which have a common need, a common capability, and common competence, and then are lucky enough to have the political will to actually cooperate. So we look at this region, and the Arab-Israeli areas, the Levant's tensions within the Levant, North Africa, it's already been mentioned, having been to Morocco and dealt with Algeria, I think that 2030 is a little early to see any significant cooperation between those two countries. We have an ongoing set of struggles in Syria and Iraq that spill over into much of the region. We have another set of tensions and conflicts in the Red Sea. We have a major arms race involving hundreds of billions of dollars between Iran and the Arab Gulf states. And we have a very deeply divided Gulf Cooperation Council, and I would just say that in general, they're probably doing as badly in the military areas of the alliance as they are in the energy side. You look at this and you also see, in the case of what's happening in Iran, and you look toward 2030, the nuclear issue may or may not be resolved. But you now have a massive new arms race in conventionally armed missiles and rockets, and a major Iranian search for precision-guided systems, which would radically change that threat. You have an Iranian effort to find Russian or Chinese arms. You have the fact that within the Gulf Cooperation Council, you have the UAE and you have Saudi Arabia. The other states are sort of byplays, particularly Qatar, largely dependent on the US. You have two countries, Oman and Saudi Arabia, spending over 10% of their economies on military and arms sales, based on a time in which their export revenues were roughly twice what they are now. So these are fundamentally unsustainable force postures on a national level, but there is no indication since 1980 of moving in a serious way towards real cooperation, standardization, and interoperability. In the real world, if those countries have to fight a power like Iran, they have to depend on U.S. battle management, IS&R, support, reinforcement, and resupply, plus that of their European suppliers. Now, these are realities that I think are compounded by the fact you have within each of the countries a serious problem in governance, population pressure, and internal stability, which stops them in the real world from cooperating in many aspects of counterterrorism. And having worked with the individual countries, let me say that having a facade like the Manama Dialogue or the current Gulf Cooperation Council meeting is just what it is. It's a facade. The more you probe, the less there is, and the more wasteful, duplicative, and isolated the efforts are. I think we really have our own problem in trying to decide whether what should be regional cooperation that is now dependent on us is going to have that same level of U.S. involvement and support. And if it doesn't, the idea that problems push people toward being wiser and more cooperative is something where I'd almost ask for a show of hands as to how many people have found this to be a dominant theme of history. The reality is that I think it's pretty clear it isn't. Now, how do we cope with this? We cope with it as we have in the past. We work to stabilize where we can. We take advantage of the countries that will cooperate to the extent we can. And often we simply watch the situation in some ways deteriorate. And here, quite honestly, I would say that one good way to look at this is what was done in the recent Arab Human Development Report for 2016. Because if you look at that, there is chart after chart listing the kind of problems in cooperation, interaction between states, and the interaction between security, failed governance, corruption, economic problems. And here, I guess I would just close with the fact, I think it's an open contest, honestly. What has been the most damaging aspect of what's going on in the region? Is it the waste of money on arms sales, repression, counterterrorism efforts, or is it the failed economic development dictated by state policies which focused on the government and state sector, did not reform, were corrupt, and used crony capitalism? That's the examination question for the audience after this session is over.
Let me ask you about sort of balance of power and sort of achieving, trying to achieve some kind of stability that way. And we look recently at the Middle East. There were periods, despite the hostilities and all the problems that we knew, that at least there was a form of stability. Occasionally it was broken. If you take the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait, the U.S. led a coalition, reacted, restored some kind of status quo, as it were. And that held in terms of regional conflict for a good while. Some people maybe point to the 2003 invasion of Iraq as kind of a turning point, empowerment of Iran, then the Arab uprisings, which led to failure in Syria, troubles in Iraq and Yemen. And certainly, you know, as I mentioned in the sector relating to military, very unrealistic to imagine broad regional military cooperation. But since there was a certain form of stability achieved in the past, at least through balance of power, if it wasn't through cooperation, yet we are in a period of open proxy conflict, civil wars in countries fueled by regional proxies, lack of clarity as to which regional power has how much sway in which region. Could you imagine a balance of power approach? How could regional players try to reinforce that. As you mentioned, even the GCC doesn't cooperate much, let alone GCC cooperating with Egypt and Turkey to create some counterforce. And the U.S. under Obama was somewhat sort of in withdrawal, unclear now with the Trump administration what they might do. But some form of stability is needed.
Well, I think you have to be very careful. Conflict is only one measure of stability. In many of these countries, you were watching the buildup of tensions, which exploded on a tribal, sectarian, and ethnic level. You created many of the forces that made Islamist extremism possible and violence possible on what is likely to be a very sustained level. And you didn't mention the Iran-Iraq war or a host of lesser internal problems, conflicts, coups, tensions, or the fact that you achieved a lot of that stability or balance through repression and through an extraordinarily high investment in military forces. Now, can you try to balance things and achieve stability? Of course you can. Can you create successful deterrence? If you call deterrence stability, and that's not a bad definition, you can probably do that between Iran and its Arab neighbors with the fact the U.S., at least now, can decisively intervene. 2030, after whatever arms transfers occur, it's more problematic. Mm-hmm. But I think you need to be very careful about what's happening, because a lot of the problems now are non-state actors. We talk about ISIS as if you could defeat it. I don't think anyone in the counterterrorism community really believes that's possible. You can perhaps break up the caliphate. You may get a name change, but you're going to have most fighters survive. And only about 12% of the terrorist incidents in 2015 in the MENA region had anything to do with ISIS in the first place. So getting rid of 12% doesn't solve the problem of Islamist extremism. Mm-hmm. Now, these are realities that aren't particularly pleasant. But I don't think postulating what I can imagine is terribly useful. I can imagine lots of things. I just can't assign them probabilities.
All right, then.
And Ross, your job is easy now after that.
Yeah, sure.
But really, the segue to Ross's last paper, because he did write two papers, is looking at other regions. And as I mentioned in the beginning, you know, if you looked at Europe in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, and what happened there, it's in terms of extremist movements, genocide, failed, wars that cost 80, 90 million lives. And yet there was a transformation, or East Asia, where there are conflicts as well. And Ross, in your paper, you looked at a number of these examples, went outside of the Middle East, and tried to examine how different regions tried to move from conflict that seemed hopeless and endless to actually a different reality over years or over decades. What are some of your takeaways from those experiences around the world?
Well, first I'm going to take the liberty that the presidential candidates did during the recent debates, and that is answer a slightly different question before I get to your question. And that is,
I
think...
Is it about your emails?
No, it's not about my emails. I think if we, before we get to the question of what models, first of all, let me say there really is no particular model from another region that can be important to the Middle East. There may be lessons learned, and I will get to those. But I think before we do that, I think we really have to take a hard look at what are some of the obstacles towards cooperation in the Middle East. And many of them have already been mentioned and are obvious. The reinforcing, negative reinforcing narratives between Iran and Saudi Arabia that just get deepened by the current conflict. But there's some obstacles that I think Tony maybe alluded to that are not so obvious, and that is that we assume when we talk about cooperation that we actually have some common interests. That's an assumption that we come to the table with when we're asking the question, what can foster cooperation? And I think that's a problematic assumption to make. You know, I've had the benefit of going to the region a number of times and talking to leaders, and anytime you talk to a leader in the Middle East and you talk about common regional interests, Tony, please stay, don't leave, you get a nod, and they acknowledge that there are common interests, but that dialogue lasts about 5 seconds before they start descending into the depths of where interests conflict in the region. And so I think what that should tell us as analysts and as individuals that are trying to affect the policy or influence the policy community is that the notion of common interest itself is problematic in the Middle East. It's there, but it's a theoretical interest. So of course, any regional actor will tell you, we will benefit from stability and prosperity. All countries will have a gain. The problem is that's very hazy, it's abstract, it's theoretical, and it's cast in the long term. Whereas the conflict patterns and the conflicting interests are immediate, tangible, and that's what animates their policy decisions. So if we're going to talk about lessons learned from other regions, I think one of the things that we have to address is, can a regional framework, some kind of a regional architecture, can it help translate what is an amorphous, hazy, abstract set of interests into something tangible, where all actors, all states lose by not cooperating, and they lose in the short to medium term, and they have something to gain. And so what have we learned from other regions? Well, it's fairly checkered, history in this regard. If we look at the EU, or the origins of how the EU got started post-World War II, they found a particular area of cooperation, or you might say a particular industry that was incredibly important, both in terms of fostering cooperation and peace and also preventing war. And that was the coal, the European coal and steel community. And the idea there was to take an instrument or set an industry, two industries that were instrumental to two things. One, instrumental to war, the war-making capacity, but also economically very, very important to both countries. And they used that as a wedge. It wasn't perfect. The causality between the European coal and steel community and the EU is weaves around. It's not clear 100%. But what we do know is they found an angle in. And so the question for the Middle East is not, can the Middle East mimic what the EU is or was, because that certainly is not applicable. But I think the question for the Middle East, is there a counterpart to the European coal and steel community that could create a foundation for some form of cooperation that ultimately could lead to more advanced forms of institutionalization in the Middle East? And one of the things I focused on in my paper, and I to say that I have to pay homage to another author who's not here today, I'm going to butcher her name, I'm sure, but it's Aysegul Kebirlu, who wrote a paper on water. And she essentially said that water might be an opportunity to be sort of the counterpart, the Middle East counterpart, to coal and steel for Europe. And if you look at that issue, one thing you find is that, number one, states' immediate interests, their interests in terms of domestic legitimacy, their economic interests, are affected today, not in the future. They're affected today by the shortages of water. Drought affects their food supply. It affects their conflict patterns. It affects their legitimacy. And so, and plus, this is a problem that has no state solution, state-centric solution. There has to be at least a regional solution, if not something even more global. So this is more of a question that I raise in the paper, frankly, than providing an answer. But this is maybe one area that we could look to where states have an immediate cost and an immediate a cost to do not cooperating and a cost and a benefit to cooperate that maybe is something that we can maybe draw. It's an example an endeavor we can draw from the EU. There's another problem in terms of cooperation, aside from the fact that these regional interests or common interests are very hazy, and that is that when we ask states to cooperate, let's think about what we're actually asking them to do. We're asking them to spend political capital, and in some cases financial capital, in the short term for a benefit that at best is long term. Now that's a hard enterprise even for the U.S. government, where they don't, where legitimacy issues are not at the forefront. Go to the Middle East today, where you have refugee crises, you've got civil wars. Asking states to invest and spend political capital today on things that are unlikely to affect that regime's survival and will only benefit their country in the long term, that gap is a very, very difficult gap to bridge. And it's a proposition that's a losing proposition. So I think if we're looking for any form of regional, what role regional frameworks can play, it's addressing that issue. And Paul, you asked the question, I'm starting to answer your actual question you asked, which is good news. If we look at other regions, for example, ASEAN is not perfect by any means. It has been called a talk shop as opposed to a walk shop for a lot of good reasons. But one of the things that they did was they focused, particularly in the 1980s, focused on particular investment promotion types of activities. And the what that did was it played to the legitimacy interests of each of those countries. And what they found is if they can, the states will cooperate with each other, even just a little bit, if it burnishes their legitimacy, if it enhances their legitimacy. They're willing to spend political capital if it has an immediate political payoff, something that we haven't seen in the Middle East. So, and what that did is it actually did, in a modest way, but still did, it did accelerate or catalyze further types of cooperation between certain countries in Southeast Asia. So the question is, well, what does that bring that back to the Middle East? What does that mean? That means that likely, before we see any form of move towards a regional architecture, you're gonna have to find some pathways in. Even if it's, we have one author who wrote, Bernard Hookman, who basically said, you cannot rely on states to cooperate, but we can look at particular sectors or businesses that might be able to, who have an interest in cooperating, and approach regional cooperation through the back door. And so I think that's probably one of the lessons that we learned about the Middle East, but also that we learned coming from the Southeast Asian experience.
I wanted to ask you, in your paper, you distinguish between regionalization mm-hmm. and sort of regional cooperation. Yeah. And if you look at work like that of Parakhana's mm-hmm. new book, Connectography, and looking at trends in the world and the trend towards increasing connectivity that Parag talks about, and you compare economies, societies in the 50s to economies, societies today, and if we look forward, that both physical connectivity as well as virtual connectivity and all the rest of it. And in your paper, you describe regionalization as simply a natural proliferation of these small tentacles of connection and connectivity as something that might be happening naturally that could be helpful in the long term. How do you see the differences between those two phenomena?
Well, first of all, I say in the paper that regionalization can happen organically, can happen naturally. It's unlikely to happen naturally in the Middle East because we talk about the Middle East as if it is a region of connectivity, whereas in reality, it's a region of geography. It's not a region of connectivity. So if you're going to start the process of regionalization, it has to happen artificially. It has to happen either from leadership within the Middle East or has to happen from initiatives, like I mentioned earlier, from outside the region. But you raise a very important point, Paul, and that is the connection between regional, not just connectivity and regionalization, but the relationship between regionalization and regional architecture. And one of the things that I've seen a lot of, when I was writing my paper, I had to do a lot of research on what has been done in other regions. And there's been a lot written about how ASEAN could be a model for the Middle East and so forth and so on. And they treat regional architecture as if it is an end in itself. Whereas if you're going to think about a regional framework for the Middle East, you have to think about it as a means towards an end. That it has to be a means towards cooperation. And if you're going to get to that point, you have to be somewhere on the continuum of regionalization. In other words, you have to have certain kinds of interdependencies. We don't have interdependencies. We have theoretical, as I mentioned before, we have theoretical interdependencies, but we don't have tangible interdependencies today. So the regionalization that we're talking about has to come through particular initiatives. And those initiatives could, as they have in to some degree in ASEAN, come after a regional architecture has been put in place, or they could come in the case of Europe, where before the EU was formed, you had sort of a wedge. You had an opening called the European Steel and Coal Community. So where a regional architecture falls on the continuum of regionalization and how that plays to cooperation is something that has to be figured out for the Middle East. It's not clear what the pathway is.
Thank you. I have one final question for Ross, and then I'll turn it over to the audience, so do prepare your questions. We've talked a lot on the panel and in the papers about economic drivers, water resources, technology, and so on. And yet, in many cases in history, in many cases in the region, it's been leadership, a decision and a leadership that's implemented a certain vision, whether it's how, as you mentioned, Europe was transformed through the visions of certain leaders. Sadat to Jerusalem was a transformative moment. I'm reading a biography of Garibaldi in Italy that Italian unity would probably not have happened if it weren't for this, him and Mazzini and others. So my question is, to what degree are these just forces that will play out sort of anonymously? And to what degree, and when you look at Europe or ASEAN and so on, what role did individuals play, leaders, and how transformative can that be?
Well, I think you mentioned sort of how much of history is determined or shaped by individuals, and how much of it is shaped by political forces. I think in almost every region, it's a combination of the two. In the case of ASEAN, you had a particular opportunity, I think, in terms of the armistice between Malaysia and Indonesia. But you also had leadership that surfaced at that period of time and a certain vision to push that forward. And I think you could make the same argument with Manet and Schuman in Europe. If you're asking me, if the unspoken or unasked question is, where can we expect leadership to come in the Middle East? That really is an open question. I don't see in the current environment, I see potential leaders, but I'm not sure they have the political capital to put out in terms of actually putting their necks on the line like Sadat did, literally, in 1978 to make a move towards any kind of regional cooperation.
Yeah, so, my question wasn't getting at, is it there and who's it going to be? But I think it underlies an important point that while, as Tony said, looking at realities and so on, you can be justified in being 100% pessimistic. Mm-hmm. None of this is going to happen. And yet, sometimes the role of leaders can make some mm-hmm. kind of transformative difference that could be a window of, a variable that could change the calculations and provide agent of change occasionally.
Yeah, I think the other approach to that question is, what are some of the inflection points that could arise? Is it the end of the civil wars in Syria and Iraq that is an opportunity for then leadership to arise? Historically, there's always been a personality or a group of individuals who have pushed the historical force forward. But normally there's been some opening, some event. In the case of the African Union, it was the decolonization that was kind of the impetus in Asia. As I mentioned, it was Malaysia and Indonesia, the armistice there. Europe, it was the end of the war and so forth. So it's a combination, I think, of the two.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Ross. Let me turn to the audience. I think we have microphones. We do. I'll start with a gentleman in the fifth row. Introduce yourself and make your question or short remark. Microphone.
Thank you very much. I have been professor at the University of Tehran, the Persian, and I'm teaching at Montgomery College. I have experienced whatever Mr. Fardoust says to Anthony Cordesman and him and you. I started with the integration theory, as Haas says, and then when I was at Harvard as a fellow, Hoffman and also Amy Huntington told me, okay, how much do you have? I said, 30,000, and said, you must be genius. Then I turned back to Iran. I started working on a policy given to Rouhani and said, constructive interactionism. He purged me and told the intelligence not to let him in. Now you see, the president-elect comes, you see, the Lebanon and Saudi Arabia and Iran, they come to, let's say, compromise. I'll call it, as I say, I don't know, sensational opportunism. it doesn't go with theory. It doesn't go with rationality. The way that you say it is idealist or realist. And I practiced in Iran for 41 years. It didn't work. Could you say that, okay, if I'm wrong, and correct me, I appreciate it.
Okay. Let's take a few comments and questions if panelists who feel that the question is directed at them take notes. And we'll, yes, the gentleman in the fourth row. Then we'll come over.
Herbert Regenbogen. I'm a professor of international relations in Kiel University, Germany, and in Touro Law School in New York. My focus and question is on downsizing the regional aspect of the Middle East to the Eastern Mediterranean, and using that really in terms of three pillars. The overhaul of the economy through the diversification of energy discoveries, and the climate change. Each of these instruments have already taken on political economic calibrations. So there is water transported from Turkey to northern Cyprus. There is the discovery of moving these energy resources to infrastructures for trading nations, among them Israel, Cyprus, Egypt. And in the historical context of the last 7 years, because this is when it really began in 2009, is there not really this model of cooperation to be found in a historical context? And because of that historical context, the question then arises, is the architecture that we are using as a precursor really evolving and presently allowing major powers like the United States to come up with a Marshall Plan that can be the catalyst for this stability and this idea, like Robert Shuhin?
Thank you. A question from a colleague, Mr. Iqbal.
Mr. Iqbal, I'm an adjunct scholar at the Middle East Institute. Interesting subject. Well, you see, Middle East is not an economic region. So to think about that as the economic foundation as a basis for integration is, I think, a very amorphous kind of an idea. We're not going to get anywhere if we were to look at only the economics part of it. Regionalization has already taken place. There are different regions in the region itself, or sub-regions, which have already established their relationships with the rest of the world on their own terms. GCC with Southeast Asia, North Africa with Europe, et cetera, and a number of other countries that are left in the middle which have not nowhere to turn or to each other. There is little of vertical or what we call horizontal integration in the region, and for obvious reasons. The only thing common in the region is culture and the language. These two are very important variables. My point is to assume and expect that somehow or the other from out of nowhere we'll be able to generate forces that will then marshal the economic factors or strategic factors to bring all of these countries together under a common umbrella is an unrealistic one for a long time. So I think the way I see it, although I'm an economist and I ought not to be getting into this issue, the only area where I find that some sort of degree of cooperation is possible and is happening without any effort is culture. And that can provide a much stronger foundation for us to go anywhere. ASEAN was, in fact, that's how it began. It was really more of a cultural issue before it became an economic and political and strategic issue. So my point is, what are we doing? Are we, the external forces in the region, able to push it? Or should we let the region itself decide for itself how it wants to move, and to what extent is it going to accept the commonality of language and culture to establish the foundation that is needed for the growth?
Thank you, Zubair. Let's go to the panelists for a few quick responses, maybe Shahrokh, from picking whatever you might want to respond to and move right.
Yeah, I think a general answer to a number of questions that have been raised is that, and I think Mr. Cordesman also raised this issue, is that the current growth model in that region is not working anymore. It's a state-centered, state-captured type of a model of economic development is producing growth rates about 3%, and if you deduct from that the population growth, about 2%, 1.8%, you will see that the per capita income in many of these countries growing by 1% a year if things are going well. There is no buffer. If there is a shock, regional or external, there is a, you know, growth dives. Even that growth, with labor force growing at 2.5%, has meant very high unemployment rates, around 15 to 20% for the region. Among the youth, educated youths, around 40%. Only maybe 15 to 20% of female, potential female labor force participation is being used, although female literacy rates are as high as male literacy rates. The population of female students in universities are a higher percentage, 55, 60% in many of these countries. So huge amount of resource going to human capital, but they're not being utilized. It's the best brains are migrated, or they have become an army of unemployed, and there will be many more shocks to these systems coming from as this, the population of the unemployed will continue to rise, because there is no growth model that has replaced the old one. So no matter what we talk about cooperation, and cooperation was, I mean, I mentioned it because that gives an additional potential impetus to further growth. Mm-hmm. But the current model is not working. And the major problem also has to do with, you know, corrupt governments, you know, and the non-transparent, non-accountable governments, not in all cases, but in most cases. And the fact that the governance situation also has affected businesses. Most of the businesses that are active in the region are very large businesses that are favored by the governments, and small and medium-sized enterprises have no access or have little access to finance. Those are the type of firms that will produce jobs. So business climate has to improve. Governments have to improve governance and become more accountable, more transparent. And the model has to go from public sector-led growth to private sector-led growth. Mm-hmm. And that will generate huge number of jobs over time, but it has to start soon. So I think we should not really bother so much with trade and regional cooperation as being the main engine. The main engine is going to be domestic reforms, mm-hmm. in this country.
Okay. Jean-Francois?
Just a couple small points. I'm not sure I agree with Iqbal on the cultural side. It's very important. It's vital. But I think the biggest problem, there are many big problems, but one of the big problems today is the relationship between Iran and the Gulf countries. And there the language doesn't really matter. You have the religion, of course, is somewhat problematic at times, because each sector is trying to use their own sect to their advantage, or which could be changed. But still, I think what's very interesting to me is what was mentioned by Ross, is the potential of development considering the past. I mean, I come from a French background, and I've seen the destruction of France and Germany, which was 20 million people died, and they managed to get back together and work a system that is actually very efficient and has problems, of course, but it works very well. And I think that's Ross is pointing out to that it's not all hopeless. So I think the culture is very important. But I think if we can do something like an economic development, just like the steel and coal community, you could have the crude oil and chemical community, you know, could very well work between Iran and Saudi Arabia, not tomorrow. But if we're talking in a period of 20 years, I think there's some hope there. So I'm not overly negative, and not, you know, the Mediterranean cooperation could really go along the same lines. And sometimes what is the most depressing and the most hopeless situation can turn out to be a blessing in disguise in some ways.
Thank you, Jean-Francois. Tony?
Well, the word Marshall Plan was mentioned, and I think it's an interesting phrase, because all of us think, well, if we only could find the right development plan and we had the resources, well, historically, the plan is largely irrelevant. There was no Marshall Plan. You provided relief on loans and money in after World War II, which you didn't after World War I. Individual countries recovered on the basis of their industrial base. There is a serious problem often in interpreting how long it took, because you still had the impact of World War II very visible in Britain, Germany, and other places in the early 1960s, and I say that having been there. And I think the problem we face in this region, and it hasn't been mentioned, is a recent UN report talking about the cost of the Arab Spring put the uprisings and conflict as having had a cost in $650 billion in terms of development. That report came out about 3 weeks ago. The report on Arab development that came out for this year, which is relatively recent, raises these same issues. It also notes that about 46% of the casualties and terrorist incidents in the world are concentrated in the MENA area. You have a very serious ongoing problem of instability, and to have growth and stability in the middle of this, the displacements and the rest is critical. More than that, when you talk about subregions and countries, remember that if you look at the per capita income of Qatar and compare it to Yemen, which isn't that far away, the ratio of per capita income today, and the estimates are somewhat uncertain, is that Qatar has a per capita income somewhere between 20 and 25 times the per capita income of Yemen. And talking about sort of common interests is rather difficult. You also, again, you asked us to look at 2030. Well, by then, I assume oil and petroleum will be back to $100 a barrel. But in the interim, let's remember that we have a massive economic crisis going on in the petroleum exporting states spilling over into the others. So, yes, if you had enough money, proper internal structures, and a competent ability to plan on the outside, and one might consider what happened in Afghanistan and Iraq when the U.S. tried to do it, you might be able to move forward. But boy, would I be careful, and that gets to the issue of theory versus practice. I guess I'm getting too old, but frankly, where theory can't be put into practice, I tend to think it's rubbish.
Russ.
Okay. I think we should be mindful of the baseline we're looking at in terms of cooperation today. As everybody has said, the baseline is extremely low. And if we look at the region, to the degree that the Middle East is a region, Tony, please stay still. To the degree the Middle East is still a region, it's a conflict system. You know, it's not a system. So the question of cooperation does not necessarily suggest that we need to aim particularly high. I spoke, when I was giving my talk, I obviously spoke about particular initiatives in which the region might be able to come together. But de-escalation of the current conflict is a form of cooperation. Working the international powers, recognizing that what starts in the Middle East doesn't stay in the Middle East. It's affecting the politics in Europe, it's affected the politics potentially in the United States. And the notion that somehow the international arena could help the regional powers at least de-escalate at some point in the current conflict is not that far-fetched, I don't think. It's much more far-fetched to think further ahead and say, how could that generate a positive economic development model? How could you lead to water cooperation, security cooperation? That's a bit far-fetched. But our baseline is so low today that I do think we should be asking, sort of, how do we define cooperation? And cooperation can be de-escalation. It can be just getting back to zero, getting back to the region being not a conflict system, not a cooperative system, but just being a neutral system. And then from there, perhaps we can build from, build from there.
Thank you, Ross. I want to emphasize that, I mean, the interdependency in the region is extreme, and it's security related, and it's that we're tearing each other apart. And in a way, that's similar to the European condition, that they had to invent something to cooperate on, because their interdependency was so negative.
Right.
And also when, you know, looking at sort of policymakers in the region, if one thinks of, you know, wanting to get to a stable, economically productive and safe society, and to think that you can do that in a region at war is completely unrealistic. So if you're not thinking regionally but want to have a stable regime, administration, government with a population that has enough income not to revolt, you have to also think, it's one of the things that you sort of pushed to think about out of domestic necessity. And I agree with you that, you know, a lot of that is just getting to zero.
Yeah.
I'd also indicate that it's not that far-fetched in the sense that even after the Iran-Iraq war, Iran and Saudi Arabia came to a kind of detente, and there were mutual visits. I would remind that, you know, the Assad regime, which was an ally of Iran, was on excellent terms with Saudi Arabia. There are billions of dollars of GCC investments in Syria, which was an Iranian ally. Lebanon continues to be an area where they coexist and cooperate. Turkey, before the uprisings, had created a common economic zone or was in the process of building it with Syria, Lebanon, and Jordan. So we are in a very dark moment now in these years, but there are possibilities even within the region for some change. I would also indicate that the pessimism that we talk about in terms of regional cooperation, which is real, that's the same pessimism which is realistic about, well, how do we do domestic political reform? How can Egypt become politically more stable? How do we do the difficult economic reforms? They're all difficult. And we can, and, you know, being a pessimist in the Middle East on all of these things means being a realist, and you're probably sadly going to be right. But we're putting out, I suppose, ideas for reformers that if you want to improve the domestic political system and the economic system and the regional system, if you want to do that, these are some of the ideas that can be put out there. Let's take two final questions, and then we close the gentleman in the back in the green sweater.
My name is Dan Silverstein. I'm a strategic advisor, private sector and capital markets aspects of agriculture and economic development. And with greatest respect to all of these extraordinary scholars in the room, I have the solution.
Oh. Cameras are whirring, so...
I would propose that you call a conference of farmers. Not seed breeders or equipment manufacturers or purveyors of big data, just men and women farmers, and create a collaborative effort in which they share solutions and problems, turn them into rock stars, let them increase the volume and the nutritional quality of food, let them be recognized as a regional collaborative effort. It will capture the attention of women. Many of those women will be the wives of the men creating the regionalization problems. And I think that they will create the political will to find a solution.
Well,
you're welcome.
Thank you for that. Thank you for that. Gentleman in the front row.
Good afternoon. My name is Siobhan. I am a student fellow at the East-West Center. But I also have another hat, which I work at Middle East Research Institute based in Erbil. And my question is, a commonality perspective for all Middle East region is the population pattern, or the millennials, which the majority of the population is under 30 years old. And could that be a potential for the cooperation in the region, or a disruptive force, which we have seen in the past during the Arab Spring, or the ISIS insurgency in northern Iraq? Thank you.
Thank you, Siobhan. And the last question, gentleman in the second row.
Hussein Ibn Yusuf, International Petroleum Enterprises. Let me offer a view which is a bit more optimistic than what the distinguished panelists articulated. Let me suggest that, you know, these countries have been around for thousands of years, and there has been considerable amount of cooperation and also internal developments within those countries. Dolphin was a good example, but let me suggest that Turkey, for example, has been really a hub, a major conduit of energy, oil, gas from all over the Caspian region, from Iraq, from Iran. So there were others which were much more important. And Iran also, with the export of gas to Turkey, to Armenia, import from Turkmenistan, the current export to our future export to Iraq, and so on. But OPEC has been a major success for many of these. There was no mention of OPEC. And everything is only one side of the coin. The other one is the outside meddling, sanctions, economic sanctions, wars, and also economic development and other changes as well that no one really talked about. And let me also suggest that current lower prices might be a good opening, might be a good opportunity. What Dr. Cordesman in particular mentioned was the arms race, and that might help. Let me just finish it at that point.
Thank you very much. So with a few minutes left, I'll go in reverse order. Any final comments? Dan had the whole solution, but there were two other questions there.
Yeah, just on the youth bulge issue, I think, the millennials. I mean, it's a double-edged sword, right? As you indicated, it's been a problem. You have a convergence of a number of different trends that are affecting the stressing states in the region, and you know, water and youth bulge and empowerment of individuals is one that's actually putting a strain on the legitimacy of states. But I think you're right to say that the next generation could be a possible, because of the convergence of norms and interests and so forth, it could be a possible ray of hope. The issue really there is, how do you marshal that? I mean, and how does that, you would need a transition from one generation of leadership to another, and there's no real indication that a new generation of leadership in Saudi Arabia, for example, necessarily leads to a softening of foreign policy, So I think it's sort of back to Tony's point about, you know, the theory and the practice. In theory, it sounds great. The millennials are an opportunity. It has to be proven in practice.
Thank you, Ross. Tony, any last comments?
Well, first, let me just mention, and not facetiously, about farming. You have two basic problems. One is agricultural productivity in this region is dependent on capital and actually taking people out of the land. Second, you're already hyper-urbanized in most of the countries involved, and basically your problem is that, and it certainly isn't agriculture. But I think the more serious problem is youth, and here again I'd go back to the current Arab Development Report, which just came out, in which Ross did poll very, very extensively in ways I'd never seen before youth in the region. And it is an exceedingly mixed bag, and the reason is simple. This is an area where the population has increased by about five times or more since 1950. It's one plus a fraction in Europe. We're two, largely through illegal immigration, not just native births. That's tremendous pressure. And as was pointed out by one of my colleagues, you have an incredible rate of youth unemployment now. The Hauser effect, which is declining birth rates and population, is occurring, but not at anything like the predicted rate that people have constantly tried to apply from other regions. So as you look at development, you don't have the private sector or state employment beginning to cope with the growth of the population. Back in 2011, before all of these upheavals began, the Arab Development Reports said in most countries it would take a minimum of 10 years to get to the point where you could correct the most serious problems in male unemployment. And that assumes that women, who have the great advantage of not being able to study theology, would be pushed aside during all of this period. These numbers are pretty well laid out. They're very well documented. They're in quite a number of reports. And, you know, occasionally we might muddle theory with a few facts.
Thank you.
Jean-Francois particularly mentioned also the OPEC, which we didn't mention.
No, we did not mention OPEC, and OPEC is usually mentioned as being a very negative, but I agree with you that, in fact, it's not all bad. There are some good points. The fact that the OPEC is a forum where people can exchange ideas, which they hadn't done in the past, really. It's 30 years ago. It was everyone for himself. There is room for cooperation, and I was mildly serious when I talked about the crude oil and chemical community to copy the Europeans. But I think there is potential, very much a lot of potential there, and I think it's a great possibility. So I think we have to keep looking at that, and it's not all bad. There is a lot of potential cooperation. I would agree, though, that youth is the future. I mean, we see it very, very much in the Gulf, where the young people are taking over. Now, not all the leaders who are young nowadays, or younger anyway, change the policy. But the policy is still done on the consensus basis between the very old folks who are certain ways and the newer folks. So I think we will start seeing some changes. Now, of course, the people who are actually fighting and killing others are the young as well. So it's somewhere in between. But the vast majority of people work on Facebook, and they work on computers and everything. And that's true throughout. And so there is a commonality. And I think that's hopeful in some ways. In the meantime, we have some problems to resolve. But I'm hopeful.
Thank you, Jean-Francois. The last word, Shahrokh, is yours.
Yes, comments. Thank you. I think the suggestion on the conference of farmers, probably combining water, is a brilliant suggestion. Maybe Middle East Institute could organize that, because the region, you know, is the largest net importer of food in the world, and it's going to get worse and worse because of the water shortages and the fact that the region's population is going to rise up by approximately 125 million. Between now and 2030. On the issue of youth bulge, I think most regions in the world have taken advantage of the youth bulge called demographic dividend, because you have educated workforce added to your labor force, and combined with capital investment produces more output. East Asia's experience showed that they were able to accelerate growth by 2 percentage points a year based on their youth bulge. It lasts about 15 to 20 years. Middle East window will close by 2020 to 2025. Then they start to get problem with aging. I think the OPEC example, I think, is very good one, and I think it shows the recent agreement that their backs are to the wall. But there is this shale oil production that is going to, if the prices rise a little bit too much, go above $60, probably shale oil will come in and dampen. So there is the prices are capped basically for the next few years.
Could I have a word on the farming?
That's what, Jack, go ahead.
On the farming issue, I think it's very, very interesting, really. The thing is that it's not just one solution, because it really applies to places like Egypt and Iran, where you have large populations. But in places like Saudi Arabia, where there's very little agriculture, there is some, but very little, and the Gulf in general, then the farmers do not really matter. But in the larger countries, they do, and I think that's a great suggestion. So.
Well, we do need to close. You can continue discussions in the hallways. This is obviously a very rich and diverse discussion. We will continue working on it. Thank you all for coming, and please join me in thanking our panel for their work and their presence today.